Over the last 10 or probably 20 years, it seems to me that we've been under a pretty constant stream, by we I mean individuals such as myself and all of us in the room, pretty constant stream of messages about becoming more environmentally responsible. I'm pretty confident, can't quite see you, pretty confident that everybody here knows what this symbol or one that looks much like it really means, and that we all respond to that kind of messaging. By show of hands, you might have to do jazz hands because I can't really see. I'd like to understand a little bit more about some of these messages that you might have heard. For example, who here has heard the one about change all your light bulbs? Yeah, pretty big, yeah. How about the one about get yourself a hybrid or an electric car? And then, of course, there's my personal favorite, compost your kitchen scraps. That's a big one, yeah. Well, I think we've begun to adopt those changes. We've heard the messages and we've made changes in our lives, and mainly for the better. So much so that we've even started now to ask the businesses and the industries that we also deal with to do the same thing, to step up and shoulder some of that burden. These businesses and industries have got the attention not only of the public, but of government and various regulatory agencies as well. So much so that we even offer up sometimes financial incentives and tax breaks for these companies to actually just do the right thing. These businesses and industries are ones like the automotive industry. We're all familiar with that. Some good changes have happened there. Various manufacturing industries, certainly the utilities, and of course there's always the poster child for the environmental industry or environmental movement, the oil and gas industry. But what if I was to tell you, I should flip that ahead, these are the smoky industries. What I'd like to suggest to you is that, in fact, there's another industry. There's one that we've overlooked. Yet this industry has a huge and dramatic impact. It touches every one of us every single day of our lives. It's also an industry that has easily as much environmental impact as any one of the other ones that I've already mentioned. This mystery industry that we've overlooked is the maritime shipping industry. There was a time, not that long ago, maybe a generation or so ago, that this kind of scene would have been quite familiar to all of us. This, in fact, is Vancouver Harbour, about 120 years ago, at least part of the harbour. We would have known people personally in the maritime industry. In my own case, when I was putting my notes together for this, I remembered that my grandfather actually was in the Merchant Marine when he was a young man. And no, he didn't sail on the sailboats. It's not that long ago. However, we would have had this really important connection to the sea and to the ships. In this community, we would have been waiting for ships to come in to bring us goods from all around the world. We even would have likely been excited about the ships coming in to bring us mail. For after all, the shipping industry in those days was the communications infrastructure of its time. But things have changed. When we now look over the harbor, we tend to overlook the harbor. We don't have that same connection that we once did. Even when the vessels are up close and personal to us, we don't see it. We don't have that same connection. This is particularly ironic since we are, in fact, much more, we need the maritime environment far more, more dependent upon it than we ever have been in the past. As Rose George says in her wonderful book, and if you get a chance to get a copy, it's called 90% of Everything. Truly, 90% of everything that we consume comes to us at some point in its product life on a ship. It's amazing when you start to think about it. So how can that be? How can we have overlooked this thing? Well, part of it is that shipping has become incredibly cost-effective. It's very inexpensive to ship something across the ocean on a per-ton basis or a piece-part basis. In fact, it's so inexpensive, and I know some of you have heard this, it's actually cheaper in many instances to take raw materials from Canada, for example, ship it across the ocean, have it converted into a manufactured product, and ship it back than it is to manufacture here at home. Well, how can that be? It's all about scale. This is a view of just part of Singapore Harbor. And you get a sense of the scale of the operation. When you begin to look down that line of very large cranes that are loading and offloading those ships that are lined up down the wharf. But if you look back to the upper left part of this picture, you can see just an enormous number of containers. It gives you a sense again of the scale. And this is just one port of many ports all around the world who are involved in this kind of shipping. But it does have a cost. We're the beneficiaries of this low-cost shipping world in which we live, and yet the cost is very substantial from an environmental point of view. Let me give you a couple of numbers as an example. A few years ago, BBC published a survey, or published a report, I should say, that indicated that up to 40% of all land-based air pollution was a direct result of ships. About the same time, it was calculated, and this is astonishing to me, that the 15 largest ships contribute as much air pollution in terms of nitrous oxide, sulfur dioxide, and other particulate as all 760 million automobiles in the world. There's 90,000 ships sailing the world's oceans. So what causes all this pollution? It's because of the fuel. If you'd guessed that, you'd have been right. The fuel that they use is called HFO, heavy fuel oil, or commonly known as bunker fuel. Bunker fuel has been compared to, bunker fuel has been described as one grade of fuel better than asphalt. And you can imagine what it'd be like burning asphalt in your fireplace. Of course, this has all caught the attention of governments and the regulators. In the European Union, the regulators have established something called an ECA, Environmental Control Area. The environmental control areas are a measure to mitigate the pollution in harbors. In North America, we have regulations now that require that ships that are burning HFO burn it a couple of hundred miles offshore. But that has unintended financial consequences. And what we don't want to do is add any more, if you'll pardon the pun, fuel to the fire that supports the contention that what's good for the environment must be bad for business. I forgot one important point. A few minutes ago, I talked about that disconnectedness from the sea. There's actually a term for that. That's called sea blindness, and it's a measure of complacency that we have about the ocean. And all of these statistics and so on kind of really reinforce that. So here we've got a number of industries that we focus on, and yet we're so blind to what's going on in the sea, we forget that we're very dependent upon it. And I'll come back to that. So there are a number of things that are starting to happen in this environment. I mentioned that the regulators and so on are starting to change things, and that's actually a really good start. One of the challenges, of course, is that even though the operators of vessels worldwide have engaged some changes, which I'm going to talk about momentarily, to reduce fuel consumption by over 50% on a per-ton basis since the 1990s, which is very substantial, the problem is that shipping is continuing to grow very substantially on a worldwide basis. Since the 70s, in fact, shipping worldwide has quadrupled, and it's projected that it's going to grow another 60% in the next 20 years. So we need to address changes. We need to accelerate the pace of change in the marine environment. Some of the changes that have already started are things like the following. New hull designs are dramatically impacting the way ships move through the water. If you can get a ship to move through the water more effectively and more efficiently, you reduce the fuel burn. Propulsion systems are the same thing. Vessels are now starting to be built with lighter materials. Superstructure on large vessels is often aluminum now. And in some cases, the entire vessel is built out of aluminum. Again, lower weight, less fuel. Just like, remember the messages we talked about earlier. Many of you, I'm sure, have heard the message about slow your cars down. Slow down when you're on the highway, you'll save fuel. Same thing with ships. And in fact, ships now worldwide operate a couple of knots slower than they used to just a few short years ago, with substantial fuel savings. And the last thing that's happening, at least so far, is that New fuels are being looked at. And of course, in British Columbia, we're very aware of LNG as a potential fuel. And it's quite an exciting opportunity for not only BC, but for fuel reduction. It holds great promise. But there's another technology, and one that I'm very excited and proud to be part of, something that's here in Vancouver that we're starting to incorporate into vessels, which is the development of hybrid ships. I'd like to introduce you to the world's largest hybrid ferry. This is the Princess Benedict. It runs a route between Germany and Denmark. It's 14,000 tons. It holds about 350 cars and 1,200 people. It's similar in size. If any of you have gone from Tawasin to Swartz Bay on one of these Spirit ships, the Spirit of Vancouver Island, for example, kind of a similar size. So those are some interesting statistics about the thing. What I really want you to remember about this vessel is that what it really is a giant floating Toyota Prius. Actually, that analogy is a pretty good one. The Prius, except for the floating part, the Prius has two drive systems, a gasoline system and an electric system, and it's controlled by a computer. Princess Benedict has two drive systems, diesel and an electric system. That electric system, by the way, and in both cases there's batteries. The batteries on the Princess Benedict are manufactured right here in Richmond by Corvus Energy. We have about 400 batteries on this vessel. So, the way a Toyota works, for those of you that don't know, is when you pull away from the curb, the computer automatically selects which drivetrain to use to optimize and minimize the fuel consumption. So in that case, it'll actually use, and you may have noticed this, the electric system when you pull away. Same thing with the vessel. The computer automatically takes over and it chooses and optimizes the mix of the two drive systems to make sure that we get fuel reduction. In fact, we're experiencing with the system a 15 to 20% fuel reduction on this vessel. In addition, we're also seeing a 500,000 kilogram CO2 reduction. Very substantial savings in both counts. But the best part of all is this is a really good financial decision. This was a retrofit. The drive system was upgraded to the hybrid drive. And the return on the investment on that drive system is something in the order of 3 years. So here we've got an example where it's not only great for the environment, but it's really good business decision. I've got a couple of other quick examples for you. This vessel is called the ZeroCat 120. It's actually an all-electric vessel. It's just in the process of being completed and will be in the water in the next couple of months. It's in Norway, and it holds 120 cars and about 300 people. The interesting thing about this is, as I mentioned, it's all-electric. Because it's all-electric, we actually have batteries on board, and we have batteries on shore. The batteries on shore get recharged by the grid, which in Norway is all hydro. When the ship pulls into the berth, it automatically connects to the shore batteries, and there's a massive dump of electricity from the shore batteries to the vessel batteries to top up the fuel, if you will, every time. It takes about 10 minutes to do that. This vessel is important because it really, in my mind, is an expression of what the future holds in terms of technology, shipping technology. It incorporates most of the changes that I already talked about. It's a very advanced hull design. It's got a new propulsion system. It's new materials. It's built out of aluminum. And it's all electric. Very exciting vessel. And this, I'm going to butcher the name, but it's called the TEDxStrom. It's currently under construction in Holland. This is also a hybrid vessel, but in this case, the hybrid system is CNG, compressed natural gas, and an electric system. Again, it'll be optimized depending on what the requirements of the vessel voyages are. This vessel also incorporates 700 solar panels, which are used to not only help recharge the batteries, but to run some of the loads on board the vessel when it's underway. Again, a very clear expression of what the future holds in terms of these technologies. So, what does this all mean? Well, firstly, I expressed earlier there's a concern that you can't have good business decisions and good environmental decisions. And these are three examples where that's not true. In fact, some of the regulators behind some of these new technologies have taken a look at this and said, you know, here we've got two industries that are using similar technologies, the automotive industry and shipping. They did a calculation that suggested that a lithium-ion battery in a ship has 10 times the net value from an environmental and an economic point of view than one in a car. So we should perhaps overcome some of our sea blindness and start to remember and take a look at some of these technologies. So what does this mean to you? Well, I'd like to give you an assignment. And the assignment is to start to overcome some of that sea blindness. We need to take a step back, take some of the information that I've tried to share with you today, and the next time you hear a politician speaking about some of the harbor-related issues or shipping-related issues, maybe you can pay attention with a little bit different set of ears and eyes. Next time you read an article, and I've counted, I think, four or five articles in the local newspaper in the last couple of months, maybe you'll take a chance to read that article a little bit more and engage in the discussion a little bit more. And last but not least, the next time you look out over the harbor, you won't overlook the harbor. Thank you.